Welcome to Saving the Game. I'm Grant.
I'm Peter.
And I'm Brandon.
What? No joke?
I like to mix it up a little bit.
Okay, fair enough.
And by it, you mean our expectations. Gotcha.
Right. And yeah, so this is our 50th episode, people.
Woohoo!
I know, right?
We have been on the air for over 2 years now.
Yep. Madness. And we are actually recording this one live. We're going to have it up on our YouTube channel. Well, my YouTube channel first, and we'll move it over to
the Technically, we always record them live.
Okay, yes. But people can watch it live, and that's awesome. And we have a bunch of listener questions, and hopefully we'll get more as we go live, and people go, oh, hey, cool, they're recording. That's awesome. So that'll be fun. If you are listening to us after the fact and you want to watch the YouTube video, which will be unedited and messy and ridiculous, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or Google Plus, and we'll post a link to that video soon after this recording drop, very soon after this recording, and it'll, I'm sure, be in the show notes as well. We may even post it on our website all on its own. We'll see.
And you'll get to see exactly the stuff that I have to deal with. Yay!
You stole my line. I was going to drop that. All right.
Good. You'll see exactly why we're glad that we have Brandon as an editor.
Yeah.
Or indeed an editor at all. I mean, Brandon is an especially good one, but
any editor.
Why we need an editor.
Oh, yeah. Like this, for example. Let's see, a couple of things here. We are going to be raising money for the Bodana Group again this year during our holiday charity drive. I'm actually going to be talking with Jack Birkenstock, who you may remember as our awesome guest from the Bodana Group, the executive director of Bodana, who we had on a year or two ago. And
almost exactly a year. It was 25 episodes back.
There we go.
A few bonus episodes. So,
probably nothing like a year in real time.
Probably like a year and a month or something, yeah.
Who knows? But yes, half a show ago. That's scary. anyway, if you want to help us raise money for them, there will be a link in the show notes here, as well as in the sidebar of our website, and I'm sure we will fill our social media feeds with links to that too. Or you can just go to razoo.com, razoo.com/story/STG2014, and you'll see information for our fundraiser for the Bodana Group. And like I said, there will be links everywhere. You will not be lacking for links. It'll be fine.
Yes, we will bombard you with them, inundate you with them, flood you with them.
Yes, so look forward to that. That'll be fun. but no, seriously, the Bodana Group, if you don't know them, they do basically trauma therapy for children, specifically specializing in sexual trauma. And also they do work with first responders and other caregivers working on compassion fatigue and a few other things. And they use tabletop role-playing games as a therapy tool, which is why we love them and we think they're awesome people. Also,
well, I love them because I went to Save Against Fear, and
right. So you have like twice the love. Oh, hey, it's the podcast train.
Yes, this is something that has always been edited out. But meet Blairy the podcast train.
Blairy right. The podcast train. He's here to ruin your audio.
Right.
And
we also edited
Blairy's jingle that you've also never heard.
Yes. Anyway, Bodana Group. Check them out on the web. I'll help link to them. They're good people, and at the very least, you'll find out about them from our fundraiser page.
And Jack is watching because he just said, greetings, everyone. So greetings to you, Jack.
Hello, Jack. Mm-hmm. All right.
I'm going to try to keep an eye on questions.
Awesome. Thank you. All right.
Wow, we have a lot of these already.
Yeah, I know. One last thing before we get started on our topic in scripture. If you like what we do, take a minute to review us on your podcasting platform of choice, whether that's Google Play or the iTunes Store or RPGpodcast.com or Stitcher or wherever. Every review you give us, even if it's an honest one-star review, helps us a lot. Now, the five-star reviews, yes, of course, but an honest review that people can look at and go, okay, I like this show, or, oh, you know, I don't think I'll like this show, huge help for us. So take a minute to do that. It helps us a lot. And share us out on social media. That helps too. All right. Enough plugs. We've got scripture to read. Who wants to read Proverbs?
Come on, Brendan.
All right, 1 second.
We know you love the Proverbs.
I do love the Proverbs. Give me. I'm sorry, I'm getting it up here. All right, Proverbs. All right, Peter's little cursor is in the way. Proverbs 7. Peter's moving his cursor all around. This is the first time Peter has actively
sabotaged. Live does not mean
sabotaged.
Ruin this.
Proverbs 17:17. A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for a time of adversity.
All right, and the next one we have is Romans 8:35. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword?
And our last bit of scripture is from 1 James, James, chapter 1, verses 2 to 4. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work, so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So our topic tonight is a really broad topic, making interesting characters. We are not going to hit every possible way to make your character interesting in this episode.
We're probably not even going to hit 10% of them.
No, which is good, because it means we're not going to run out of episode material for a while, right?
Yeah, I mean, we can just keep coming back to this with, you know, slightly varied names. Exactly. Making characters that are interesting. Adding interest to your character.
Making interesting characters part 2, Electric Boogaloo.
Yes. So, I did want to start, though, with kind of a little game to go back and forth here with you guys. I think there are some common traps that new players and GMs fall into that they think makes a character interesting all by themselves. Right?
Oh, we're talking about the Batman syndrome here?
Well, Batman, yeah, that's one of them, right? I think there are things that people go, oh, well, this will be really cool. This will make a great character. And in isolation, that thing makes them boring. Whereas, you know, and it's not that the thing itself, done properly, is necessarily a bad thing. It might actually be fascinating, but it needs work, and you can't stop with just this one little thing.
Well, yes.
So I wanted to kind of go over these traps and then talk about how to do these things right or better.
Well, just from what you've said, I've got one thing jumping right off the top of my head, is that there is no one single thing that is going to make a character interesting. And so you need a collection of a whole bunch of things. So the first problem would be relying on just one thing instead of creating a fully fleshed out and developed character.
Okay, I'll buy that. I think as a general rule, that's a good thing. I think it is possible to go too far with that and have an incredibly complicated character with lots of little nuances that simply may not come out well in a story or may muddle a character's reaction to things.
You run the risk of making a character that's so complicated that you can't play them.
Oh, right. True.
You're having to do kind of an emotional utilitarian calculus to figure out how somebody's going to react to, you know, hey, a dragon just landed. Maybe you've gone too far.
True, but yeah, but that's talking about extremes. That's talking about,
well,
like, you.
We are talking about extremes, though.
Yeah.
I think a lot of this is extremes, right? They take people take this to an extreme. The first one that we're talking about here, for me at least, and I think this is probably the biggest trap for all gamers, is personal might, right? Raw character power. Are we all in agreement on that? That, you know, raw power does not by itself make a character interesting?
Of course.
I mean, look at Superman. I mean, he doesn't really start getting interesting until you start factoring in some of the relationships that he has and stuff, because he is so just puissant. You know?
Oh, sure.
He's indestructible. He can fling mountains, and some versions he can turn, you know, time backwards by flying around the earth, and it's crazy.
Right. And so the writers of Superman have to work really hard to find weaknesses or figure out little tiny holes in the massive array of powers he was given in like the 50s and 60s.
Yeah.
Where all of a sudden, you know, hey, wait, we found one thing he can't do really well. Let's let's build up a nemesis based entirely on that.
Yeah, there was a saying that I heard is like in one of the ages, Superman can't do anything that he hasn't tried yet.
Exactly. And, you know, in and of itself, that does not make a character interesting. I know I have played and created, and I am entirely guilty of this. Mm-hmm. I have made characters whose only defining characteristic was really high save DCs on their spells, guys. Oh my god. Oh wow. So cool. Let me tell you, it was the worst character. It was so boring. No. Terrible. And it's not a good character, right? Because there's no depth to it. And there's no meaning to, hey, I'm an incredibly powerful person. What are the consequences? Loot.
Yeah. The thing is, a lot of what makes a character interesting is the places where it's weak. The things that you aren't good at.
Right.
More than, because the things that you have to struggle with, because that's where all the drama is. I believe in the direct quote from my class that I had was, drama equals characters in conflict. And so if there's no conflict, if you're just going to overcome, well, then you have Mary Sue, and no one likes Mary Sue.
Right.
And that particular comment, I think, segues well into Jack's question, so I'd like to hit that here.
Yeah, all right.
All right, so Jack Birkenstock wrote, what are your thoughts on injecting deeply personal material into one of your characters, and if you are comfortable with sharing this, where are you actively challenging inner struggles? Do you think that it is possible to gain benefit from this? And yes, it is definitely
possible
to gain benefit from it. In fact, actually, I just had a conversation that night where I mentioned that I have a lot of characters that have facial scars and was kind of wondering what's the psychological thing behind that. And he's like, well, do you have some kind of a mistake or misstep in your past that has helped you move forward but that you want to make sure you never forget? That's the scar. Yeah, and I kind of stopped, and I was like, yeah, that's almost me in a nutshell. Obviously, I'm not going to go into what that stuff is here, but very true. So I think sometimes little details like that creep in, whether we intend for them to or not. But I think there is definitely some value in doing it intentionally. That Lord Soth character that I have mentioned a number of times on the podcast, I think I kind of worked through some anger issues and stuff with him, and I think that was definitely beneficial. How about you guys?
Well, I'll tell you, one of the characters that I still think about the most was a Celestial Chorister character in a mage game. This was the 3-year prologue to the vampire game. That I am not in. But this particular character was a Catholic priest, and I created that character specifically so that I would have to address my own disinterest in faith at that particular time. It was very much kind of a challenge to myself of, okay, let's put my faith front and center in this character so that I can't ignore it. Because, you know, okay, going to church, that's a lot of work, gotta get up on Sunday, I gotta read, I gotta, you know, get dressed, I gotta do all this. Oh, man, that's no fun. Oh, well, Chrissy and I are, you know, she's Southern Baptist, I'm Presbyterian. There's a lot of problems with that. What? Oh, hey, mage game? Oh, I'm down every Tuesday. Let's go. Right? And so it was a good opportunity for me to kind of test myself in a way and focus on something that I knew was important, but I was kind of avoiding out of, you know how you sort of avoid things that you feel guilty about and that sort of snowballs and soon you've completely forgotten about it and you dread going back to it?
No, I have no idea what that's like.
Yeah.
Not okay. A universal part of the human condition or anything.
Glad we're all on the same page on that. Basically, I used that character to force my own hand. So yeah, I think it's very possible to challenge inner struggles.
And very beneficial.
Oh yeah.
We do have another question here that's kind of about what we just started talking about. To finish up my little thing about this issue, I believe that you can gain benefit from it. I haven't really addressed anything personally, except if you want to talk about, I used to really, really hate the concept of playing evil characters until I played one. And that changed. I'm like, oh, okay, and that opened up my... I don't think that it was necessarily a problem, but more of just a discovery. So yeah, I could see if you're trying to deal with this, it's a really good thing to do. But I did notice it looks like Nathan Ray responded directly to what we were saying. An overly powerful hero might not be interesting, but couldn't an overly powerful villain be interesting based on how much fear it can cause in the hearts among the heroes? And...
Well, okay, overly powerful is kind of one of those leading phrases, right? Are we talking about this guy is really powerful, how do we deal with him? Or this guy is really powerful because the GM won't let us do anything?
Yeah.
Right.
And I think that really varies because I don't find Doomsday to be a very interesting villain, but I think Dr. Doom is fascinating.
Yeah, I'll buy that. Doomsday is big, strong... I exist because we needed something big and strong to kill Superman. Yay.
Yeah.
Whereas, Doom
is complex and somewhat sympathetic and has all this nuance and is kind of this Renaissance man. And
and power is good, and this is going to be, to circle back to our list of questions, right, or list of topics to talk about, power is good when... using that power has consequences, and the question is, are you willing to pay that price? There's a line from, I want to say, The Wheel of Time, right, where the Aes Sedai are talking, and they're basically talking about power, and it's like, how do you pay for power? And the answer that they came back with was, do what you want, then pay for it.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Right. Or it was either do what you want or do what needs to be done, then pay for it.
See, the thing that I get with here is actually, I do think overpowering or a seemingly unbeatable villain can be interesting. But it's talking about the perception versus actual power. If this villain can just stomp on the heroes and there's nothing they can do, well, I guess you could have it in certain types of games, but it's going to really change the type of game you have. But I have run games where, like, the villain has been built up so much, but the PCs on a normal day would probably not have been able to deal with this guy, but there was always this one thing. Like, this thing that happened, I'm able to deal with it now.
Well, and I think you do want to avoid, to swipe a little bit of FTB parlance, a BVBA, who you just cannot, do anything to and is always going to win and run away laughing and stuff. That's not interesting. Yeah. That's just frustrating.
Oh, sure. Well, and here's the thing. An overly powerful hero, why are they not interesting? Because there's no particular challenge and that they can't overcome, or... It's binary, right? Did I overcome the challenge, yes or no, through whatever physical or mental or spellcasting or whatever means I've got, okay? Is there a question about whether or not they can? Will they have to think hard about it? Okay, now it's interesting. Is there a cost that they're going to have to pay? Okay, now it's interesting. If we can ask the same questions about the villain, then yes, they're interesting. And I would say even if they are particularly powerful in some particular aspect, if they have a weakness that can be exploited or, something that they are willing or not willing to do that you can take advantage of as, the heroes of the story, then I think you're on the right track with the villain.
Well, and I think also along those lines, I think power level is almost irrelevant to interest. It's how much do they feel like a person? I mean,
because we were talking about Superman. Green Lantern is typically on about the same level as Superman, right?
Yeah.
Superman bores me. Green Lantern, fascinating.
Well, and I mean, to use an example from our Shadowrun campaign, how powerful is Sand? It really doesn't matter. Everybody loves him.
Doesn't matter. As an As an arms dealer, he's probably fairly powerful. As a troll, he's certainly got some physical might, even if he's not, you know, hardened street samurai powerful, right?
Right.
So, he's got plenty of power, but who cares?
Yeah. None of us care about that stuff. We just go and talk to him and stuff.
Exactly. And Jack actually had a follow-up question that I want to address. What if the overly powerful hero is challenged by his power being minimized or ineffective in a circumstance? And I want to talk about that because that's one of the other things that I think people screw up when they're talking about interesting characters. Remember I was talking about Green Lantern?
Yeah.
Okay, what happens when you take Green Lantern's ring?
He turns into a regular dude.
In a bad story, he's a regular dude who whines about not having his ring until somebody else gets it back. In a good story, Green Lantern figures out how to get his power back.
Yeah.
Okay?
Or he does something really cool without it.
Right. Hey, just because I don't have my ring doesn't mean I'm not a smart, capable person with all these other skills. You know, there were Green Lanterns who were airplane pilots. There are Green Lanterns who were engineers. I remember talking about one comic where one other lantern was talking about one of these lanterns who was an engineer, an architect. And when he constructed things, every single bolt and rivet and screw in the entire construct was held within his mind and made manifest through the power that he wielded. That's really cool. And just because he doesn't have a ring doesn't mean he's not going to be able to think along those same lines and have that kind of mental capacity.
Well, and Kyle Rayner was an illustrator. So, yeah, exactly. I mean,
you know, it's very
artistic. Everything he made was cool looking, yeah.
Right. And so you have these different talents, whereas in bad stories, lost the one source of my power, I'm boring now. And again, I have made characters who were boring when they lost the one and only source of their power.
Well, right? I mean, was King Arthur a great hero because he had Excalibur or because he was a wise king?
Actually, it was the scabbard.
Yeah, okay.
The scabbard that made him invincible, and the sword he pulled out of the stone, and all of the ridiculously powerful and incredibly holy knights. But yes, I get your point. The fact that he had a magic sword did not define him. Right?
No.
He had other talents that made him a good character. So to get back to Jack's question, if he's challenged by the power being minimized or ineffective in some circumstance, if he's challenged by that, awesome. If it means, why don't you just go pick up the pizza? You're not really important anymore. Then you've got a problem.
Yeah, it's like the kind of argument with Aquaman. It's like, well, Aquaman is really great underwater, but if you're not dealing with fish, then what the heck? And they've done other things that have made him a little more powerful now, but like he's really powerful, but now he's on land and he has nothing to do. Well, then I wouldn't call him powerful. I would say that he's powerful in theory, but not.
Well, and they don't play up enough of his other traits, right? Like he's a king, so he should have that kind of royal bearing, and he's got all of this fighting skill with the trident and stuff, and yeah, right. They leave a lot on the table with him a lot of the time, I feel like.
But the one thing I do want to say is, yeah, you definitely can have a story about a really powerful guy who's like somehow losing his powers, because that has happened a lot in the stuff that Jim Butcher has written. Like, sure. Both Codex Alera and Dresden Files, like, you have some pretty powerful characters. And in Codex Alera, it's all about the character who is the weakest person in the world. Everyone else has magic, he does not have magic, and he saves the day. Which makes him really interesting. But in Dresden Files, Dresden's a huge wizard, he's got all this power, but a lot of times, in like the big huge climax, he says, I'm out, I have no more power, I'm done, there are limits I've reached, but he still finds a way to pull out by some other really awesome thing, which is why I love Dresden.
Yeah, and he leans on other characters who don't have his same sort of power, like Murphy, right? So, and again, talking about the Wheel of Time, a lot of times those characters are cut off from their magic power, and it's still, alright, well, can't do that. I'm not out of the picture here, guys. Let me do something. Mm-hmm. So, next one that I wanted to hit on.
I apparently got a point. Yeah.
Good job. Good job getting points. Pretend internet points for the win. All right. Beauty and charisma. This, I think, goes really strongly towards that Mary Sue thing. You know, oh, everybody loves this particular character because, you know, he is the prettiest elf, right? Or, you know, oh, he's the manliest of men, and everybody goes, wow, those muscles. If I remember correctly, in second edition, D&D barbarians got social bonuses because, oh, everybody loves that. This one I don't think is maybe quest. I think we're all know how to do this.
Hello?
Hey. Grant, you're cutting out a little bit.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Is this any better?
Yes.
Considerably.
Okay, good. Ah, the magic of editing. So, I think most people know how to deal with this, so I don't think this is a huge problem at games unless the entire game is look how pretty all of our vampires are. And yes, I'm picking on vampire players here a little bit because I'm good friends with a lot of vampire players. but, you know, I think it's still a common mistake that new people make, and maybe that's peculiar to insecure people sometimes. I have no problem making a hideously ugly character and playing it up because that's fun.
I like to play a lot of ordinary looking characters that will blend into crowds because A, it's useful, and B, it doesn't go to either stereotype.
Yeah. Yeah, the everyday hero is a favorite of yours, I know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't think we have a ton to say on that one. Wealth, I think, is another one that people mostly know how to deal with because we all saw Richie Rich when we were kids. but no, it's just, you know, okay, well, he's got wealth. Well, what happens if he isn't wealthy all of a sudden? Okay, well, everybody can kind of think through that. But I think that is a common trap, right?
Well, and I think the best way around that is give them problems that wealth can't solve.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
It doesn't matter how rich you are if somebody is emotionally distraught. It doesn't matter how much you've got in your bank account if somebody is about to, you know, is in imminent physical peril. You can't buy your way out of that.
Right. And I think even more interesting than that is what happens when you start buying your way out of problems.
And what kind of additional problems does that bring up?
Yeah. Okay, hey, I'm incredibly wealthy. Okay, and now I start showing it. Well, now all of a sudden I've got people trying to rob me. I've got people trying to swindle me. I've got people hanging around me saying, hey, I'm your best buddy, right? You wanna cut me I'm short a few thousand to the loan shark. Can you help me out? Hey, my car's kind of, you know, not doing well. Can you get me a new car? Hey, my kid is sick. Can you help me? You know, and so you start throwing out problems that having wealth itself brings, you know, this massive wealth. And then, okay, is the wealth and the lifestyle that maybe lends itself to, is that fulfilling at all, right? This is one of the things that I think good Batman writers do well, as they play up the dichotomy between Playboy Bruce Wayne and guy who actually cares about things, Batman.
Yeah.
Right? And that's true of a lot of other, you know, billionaire superheroes of all different sorts.
Iron Man and so forth.
Iron Man. One of the...
Green Arrow.
I think I've talked a lot about Doc Savage, right? This very Mary Sue-like pulp figure, but that was one of the things that they really play up in those books, is Doc Savage has a tremendous amount of wealth, but always uses it responsibly, and, you know, is very quiet about the massive wealth that he has, all this sort of stuff. And yes, is it Mary Sue-ish? Sure it is, but it's a good look into, well, here's a very wealthy person, how is he avoiding those particular traps? Well, the answer is author fiat, but, you know, for your character, you can make those happen. I love those books, but not for the main character, or the title character, I should say. The title character is not really the main character of those books. He's just the guy who shows up and things happen.
He's Captain Plot Device.
He is kind of Captain Plot Device, yes.
Of pure plutonium!
Yes, his five assistants, who are human characters that have flaws, are the people that the book actually centers on.
Well, they're not made of plutonium. They're actual humans. So
they're actual humans with things they care about. Let's see. We've kind of hit on
Pepper in a couple of some of these shorter ones real quick before we continue on here.
Yeah, sure. No problem.
What is the likelihood of this show getting a TV tropes page? If somebody wants to set one up for us, that would be great. I don't know that any of the three of us are really familiar with putting stuff on TV tropes, though.
No. Also, we're not on TV, so I don't think that's applicable.
Well, it there's actually covers. Okay.
probably never. We're a niche within a niche.
Yeah. What would you see here? What do you consider to be the best episode you've produced for the podcast?
You know, our Monsters one was pretty good recently.
Yeah, that was pretty good.
It's kind of hard for me to tell because I edited a bunch of them and Brandon's edited a bunch of them, so I've heard them over and over and over.
Yeah, and I've listened to all of them in an effort to get better, and it's, you know, I honestly, I don't know. It's, I can tell you the ones that I enjoyed the most, but that's different from best. I really tend to enjoy the ones where we get our guest hosts on, actually.
Yeah, I do too.
We've talked to a huge number of really interesting people thanks to this podcast. It's one of my favorite parts of doing it.
Yep. Let's see. Envy. Would you want to do? Yeah, Envy was a good one. A lot of the Virtues and Vices series I've enjoyed.
Well, mainly okay. I say Envy because of the huge argument that I turned into a scholarly lecture. So yeah, that was... It was the first one, so that's like with Grant, I'm. It's hard to judge because I've done some of these. So which one's the best ones you've produced? Oh, my mind is
just, okay. Here's my final answer, the last one.
All right,
we're good.
The last. One.
Right. What would you want to do for the final episode of the podcast? Go surprise! We're not done.
Take over the world.
What do you think of LARPing?
Never.
It looks interesting, but I've never done it, and I don't have the budget or time.
Y'all have fun with that.
I'm okay with LARPing, I think. Again, I've never done it, but I think it'd be difficult, although I am the consummate actor.
I will say this. I am genuinely impressed by the amount of work that goes into good LARPs from both the people who run it and the players. Massive costuming, tremendous amount of organization that has to happen. I mean, some of these LARPs are 300 people. You try running a game for 300 people while managing costumes and directing other people, it's like trying to run a weekend-long play. It's nuts.
I will say that savagely bludgeoning your friends with boffer swords is a lot of fun.
Yeah, but you can do that without pretending to be anybody. You could just hit people with a Nerf bat.
Oh, yeah, we basically did that, actually. So
And I have done games that are, while not LARPs, you know, very close to pure roleplay and very little in the way of mechanics, and those are a lot of fun. So LARPing is not my thing, but seriously, y'all have fun with that because I'm glad you're enjoying it.
Okay, let's get back on track here.
Yeah. Okay, so I do kind of want to turn this around. We've been talking a lot about strengths. I think weaknesses are another common trap for people.
Well, right? We actually do kind of have a question that goes along with
yes,
that.
Yes, we do, and I'm glad I saw that one. And this is another one from Nathan, talking about characters who are interesting because they aren't as physically powerful. So how do you make someone interesting who's emotionally or mentally weak? Let's talk about those first. First, again, is that weakness their sole defining characteristic? If yes, it's not a very interesting character.
I disagree.
Hold on. You might not disagree when I'm done. If that is their sole defining characteristic, and you're running, this is in a game, and I'm talking about this from a game perspective. I think there are other characters who can have this weakness in fiction that don't necessarily, like written fiction or plays. I'm actually thinking Streetcar Named Desire, Blanche.
Blanche Dubois.
Yeah. She doesn't have a whole lot of other redeeming qualities. She's kind of defined by various different weaknesses, and I think that's fine. In a game where you're trying to typically accomplish some goal and you are trying to be the protagonist, I think you need to counterbalance that weakness or find a way to turn that weakness to your advantage at times, and certainly not be entirely defined by it, right? And I say, you know, be whatever character it is. If it's a NPC, same thing. Unless they're just a quick one-off stereotype of some sort. But if it's a character who needs to have some depth and is going to be center stage for a while, they have weaknesses. How have they lasted this long without compensating for that weakness? You know, hey, somebody's got a physical disability, okay. What do they do with that? Someone's mentally weak in some way. They've got like a monk-like character with terrible OCD and other problems. Well, Monk functions despite those. How does he do it, right? I think that's how you have to approach it.
True, but like, see, the thing that I got from is that you can have a simple character, like a very interesting, when he says mentally weak, because I'm like, emotionally weak, well then you have a coward, and cowards are great characters, because the instant
sure,
problem...
Sure, but do they get things done despite being cowards?
Possibly. Like, it depends on the type of coward you have. I think it'd be great to play a coward who's kind of, like, forced in the situation and has to find the safe spot and, you know, do things like that and all that. And for mentally weak, all I can think is that is someone who's not as smart as someone else. I'm like, okay, that's a barbarian. And I've played plenty of barbarians who have very simplistic worldviews. Who go...
Oh, yeah, me too. The character I was talking about before with the one item weakness... Dumb as a brick. He was as dumb as I could make him in Savage Worlds, and I played him dumber.
Yeah, and that's... What is... Oh, well, I go here. All right, well, I smash this. You know, I don't understand what this is. My player knows, oh, this is what it is. Like, what would I do if I didn't understand? And that's sort of how you get into that mindset, is you say, all right, what would I do if I didn't know how to use this? And that actually makes it really interesting. Playing... below your intelligence, honestly playing mm-hmm. below your intelligence and sticking to it can actually be some of the most thought-provoking things ever, because you're thinking, what do I do if this?
Yeah. I want to come back around to cowardice before we move on too far, because there's an interesting phenomenon that happens in real life with that. Mm-hmm. A lot of the time, people who think of themselves as cowards or have been told that they are will actually be some of the most outwardly valorous and brave people, because they feel like they have to fight against their own perception.
Mm-hmm. And, right. And I think sometimes the opposite is true, is that a person who is really, really, really a coward, like, I'm reading the Codex of Valera right now, and they're at this enemy where the main character is having to be a captain and fight against this basically race of dog people called the Carnum, and he says that the person he's fighting mainly is a coward, and he knows it to be true. And this is the person who's leading an army and getting stuff done, but the fact that he is scared and cowardice is able to be used against him because he's putting out this outward show of force and like, mm-hmm. I am big and I am strong, but it's a lie. Like he's not so that the coward might be the one who's making all these brave speeches, but when push comes to shove, they're in the back.
Right. Like, well, that's almost a stereotype, isn't it? You know, the shouting leader urging his followers on the battle while he just kind of hides in the back. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So yeah, I think it's interesting in that, and you can play that up and make it mm-hmm. central, but I don't think it should, especially for a protagonist, it should define them entirely, or they overcome it. And maybe you can make overcoming that weakness kind of their story. You can.
And this is actually going to go to probably the one point that I really have, which is that in characters, as you mentioned, they're a mix of different things. Is everyone is a person who is defined by basically the pressures that society puts on them. And right. Everyone in the world has a mix of things. They don't just all accept all of the pressures, and they don't just reject all the pressures. They accept some and reject others. And that, I think, is the key to creating a good character. It's finding out which pressures are put on, what pressures are put on them, and seeing what are they accepting and what are they rejecting, and why are they doing those things. And then you will have a good character.
Yeah. I couldn't say it better. Cool. Peter, you got anything else to add?
Not to this.
Okay, awesome. Good question, Nathan. Thank you. The last thing that I wanted to hit on real quick, and then we have a whole bunch of other questions I want to get to, because, hey, live episode, and awesome listeners who have joined us. Y'all are great. Physical disabilities, I think, fall somewhat into that same category. To a certain degree, it's less intense because I think we all know people who have gotten around those, and so it's less of a, oh, look, this one physical flaw completely defines me, right? But I think that's a common mistake that very new role players will make, is to say, well, I took this one weakness, and since that's, you know, the one flaw that I took to make my stats even better, oh boy, I'm going to play that up. Or sometimes...
Captain Eye Patch, and everything centers around me lack of depth perception.
Right. Yeah, that's actually maybe one of the biggest problems is, you know, no, guys, we can't do that. I'm allergic. Nope, can't do that. I'm allergic. Nope, can't do that. I'm allergic. And I'm using allergies here as kind of a generic, kind of jokey one, but, oh, man, all the time. I've played bad characters like this because I was also a new stupid role player once. and I wish I had played them longer ago than I had.
The thing that I always think about when playing someone who has a disability, because I have thought about playing someone who has a disability. I've never brought myself to play it. But I know in the Firefly role-playing game that was put out by Cortex... I have it up on my shelf.
Well, it uses the Cortex system, yeah.
Yeah, the Cortex system, like the old one. Basically, it had one of the things about being blind and also about having precognition. And I'm like, I really want to pull those two together. Have on the ship, like, a blind female who has precognition, who's sort of this fortune teller lady who is going around with this group of thieves for some reason or another. And it's just like... I'm like,
you just made a Greek oracle in space, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Let me ask you this, though. Does the precognition completely compensate for the blindness?
No, not at all. Okay. Like, it wouldn't,
because
like...
That's kind of what I was afraid of, is the, look, it's the blind monk who, yeah, he's got his eyes covered, but he's otherwise completely fine.
Yeah. Oh, no, she would, and that's part of the reason why I would think it would be hard to play that up. I mean, but then again... One of my favorite characters from one of my favorite, series is a blind girl who is the most, you know, badass character ever. And I'm talking about Toph from Avatar.
Of course you are, because she's awesome.
It's like everyone who sees Toph is like, yeah, her being blind, while it does cause problems, because there's a couple episodes where it's like, what is on this paper? And she's like, I'm blind. Like, of course I do. Like, and there's some jokes that are played up with that, but it doesn't weaken her or make her less effective as a person, because she does have a sort of compensation of sensing through the ground, but even sometimes that is taken away from her.
Right.
And the thing that I wanted to say is, like, the other thing that just came around here is because we were talking about what would it be like if you played someone with a disability, and so I'm like, okay, well, what if they only had one arm? And I'm like, all right, well maybe that, and they're still a fighter. Okay, well, you know, they only have one arm, or they're a fighter. Well, maybe that just means that they're really driven themselves to be really good with that one arm, and so maybe they're an accomplished duelist. And the mind instantly went to Norse mythology and the idea of Tyr, who was the one-handed warrior who was the champion of single combat, because he just was.
Yeah. Tolkien borrowed slash stole that whole concept with one of his elves in the Silmarillion, who his hand got cut off and he recovered and ended up being an even deadlier fighter with that with his left hand because he'd lost his right hand and really wanted vengeance.
Mm-hmm. Okay, before we move away from this one, I want to go back to Toph a little bit because she is actually a really good example of several things that we've been talking about. Yeah. So she has a lot of personal might, right? She's the most formidable earthbender in the setting, mm-hmm. and she's got a physical disability, and those two things are part of what makes her interesting, but it's not all of it. She's got a bunch of personality traits that can kind of be good or bad depending on the circumstance. She tends to be very confident, arrogant when it's bad, and very sure of herself when it's good.
Yeah, sure.
She's kind of resourceful. She's very loyal. And all of that stuff stirred into the same pot makes her interesting.
Well, let's not even forget the fact that she comes from... She's wealthier than everyone else there. Like, Sokka mm-hmm. is a monk. Katara and... Aang is a monk. Sokka and Katara were from a poor tribe.
Right. Well, let's not spend too much time on names, because yeah. I haven't seen it, and I'm sure other viewers haven't, so...
All right. Well, she is from a wealthy family. And that's one of the things is that she basically rejects what her family wants her to be, which is this poor, you know, like, oh, she can't do anything because she's blind. And she's basically like, forget that. I'm going to be the most powerful earthbender there is. And she really pulls it off. And also in the series, you have my character who's favorite is Sokka. He's completely depowered. In a story about everyone else who has magic, he has no magic. But he still contributes. He's still interesting. He's the idea guy. He comes up with a plan, and it might be silly, but usually it comes up with something that works.
Yeah. Okay.
Awesome. Also, Grant, you really need to watch Avatar The Last Airbender.
I know. Listen, I think I've told you my plan for this, right?
Yes, you have.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Watch good. It with your daughter when she's of age, and that's a shared activity.
Exactly. And I know it's good because everyone's told me, so I don't have any question of, well, is this going to be terrible children's TV or good children's TV?
Not only is it good, I think it's the type of good that you will actually enjoy.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm sure it will be. But anyway, it's on the list.
Yeah, you're saving it up.
Yeah. It'll be years because she's two. Yeah.
Well, it'll probably be about 4 or 5 years.
By then, everybody will have stopped talking about it, and I get to be the guy who's reminding people about this cool thing.
Oh, you think that's going to happen, do you? All right. We have a couple of questions.
We have a lot of new questions.
Plus threes on here. So should we hit those?
I want to start with Jacob's. Okay. What is the most spiritually challenging campaign or character you've done, and how do you deal with it? Example, I'm doing a space opera, and my fiancé has to reconcile her beliefs of salvation with the existence of alien worlds. I find it a great exercise. You guys go ahead, because, yeah.
All right. I think the most challenging spiritual character I've ever had to play was Tin Man, which is my cleric of the Wizard of Oz that I played in a homebrew game, which actually inspired my Y2112 setting. Like, everyone who's listened to the show has heard me talk about Y2112, and I think I've mentioned on there that I built that world simply so that I could play Tin Man in it at one episode. But he basically was a very interesting, conflicted character who was kind of really, really nuts. And the thing I had to deal with is he basically built this whole faith up that was a lie. I knew it was a lie. Like, but in the Pathfinder D&D world we were playing, it didn't matter. Still, his faith gave him power. But since he was crazy and he was basically building a faith off of a children's storybook that had a couple pages ripped out, mainly the section that said, you know, the wizard wasn't actually real, like, just torn completely out, he didn't know what to do. He just was like, all right, well, I'm completely fine with this. I love this. This is absolutely awesome. And what ended up happening is I knew we were going to come to a point where it was going to fall apart for him, because in one of the houses we found an actual intact copy of The Wizard of Oz, and some of the players hid it from my character because they didn't want him to go through this thing. And then someone eventually gave it to him, and the campaign didn't last much further for us to figure out what was going to happen from there. But it was the most challenging character, because I had to deal with all these crises of faith and this really broken, damaged character who was holding on to this belief that was the only thing that was keeping him going. And it was going to blow up in his face.
Peter?
So I've been thinking, and I actually have two answers. The first one is the obvious one from that Ravenloft campaign that I've referenced a few times, because I went through and kind of used that to process some stuff that I'd been going through at the time. I think I did a lot of that processing somewhat unconsciously, but it still happened. The other one is probably going to shock you, and it's my character in the Shadowrun game, because for the first time I've been playing that kind of consciously thinking about a lot of the stuff that we talk about here on STG.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, it's kind of in my head like, you know, what does this say about me that I'm having the character do this? What kind of a message am I sending to the rest of my player group? You know, how is this going to affect my perspective on things? How is this going to sound to other people when we talk about this on the air? How does this reflect my values or lack thereof? And obviously it's not cutting into my fun at all, but it has been good to kind of try and think about that stuff some more. So, okay. Maybe not, yeah, and challenging might not be the best word there, but involved, perhaps?
I can see that. Yeah, you've definitely been paying more attention to it. And I'll tell you, as the GM of that particular game, it's interesting that I have not done a lot of that, but I think that's because we're running it in a pre-existing setting, right? In Shadowrun. Yeah. Because I can just kind of go, oh, no, that's how the world is. That's how Shadowrun is.
Yeah.
Right. I can hide behind, no, the whole setting is like this. This is what characters would do in this setting, and I don't have to give it a lot of thought. In the Inspector's game, I'm having to give it much more thought because I'm kind of inventing that out of my own head. And so it's, ooh, what does it say about me that I'm thinking about this? What do I want to really hit on this? Is this going to be a problem for anybody? Where do I take it from here? And it's a real lightweight game that you guys have a lot of input on by design, but I'm still paying it much more attention in that way than the Shadowrun game.
Well, and to go back to the Shadowrun game a little bit, one thing that I've noticed that I don't know if you're doing consciously or unconsciously, but the game has, like, the stuff that we're dealing with in the world has been getting steadily darker from the first mission.
Yeah, it has, and I'll tell you, that's unconscious. I know it's unconscious.
The thing is, it's like, conscious or not, the fact that that has been happening has been kind of making me really try and grasp where the edges of Frost's morality kind of are defined. Like the thing with the street gang out in Puyallup.
Yeah,
that was some of the stuff that we did in there was a little more ruthless than what we normally do, and I really was kind of like, "Ooh, this may inform some things later."
Yeah, and I'll tell you, one of the things I have been trying to do, and I haven't made the conscious connection, but one of the things I've been trying to do with this game is address the kind of eternal question of Shadowrunning and really all crime fiction, which is, how do you get out? Okay?
Yeah.
Everybody kind of started in the Shadowrun campaign as, well, we've been at it for a while, but we've only been doing these kind of lightweight things. And it's kind of, can we dig ourselves so deep into this criminal underworld that we somehow come out the other side? Because my wife's character wants to get out of the business. I think your character wants to get out of the business.
Well, and something else that's interesting.
The other character, but, you know, maybe. But how do you do that?
Yeah, and I think the other thing that's really interesting about that particular game and that particular setting is, you know, we're ostensibly the bad guys, right? You know, the Shadowrunners are professional criminals and stuff.
Oh, it's so morally gray. You're the least bad guys. Come on.
Yeah, but the thing is, well, that's kind of what I was getting at. It's like our little group of Shadowrunners is in a lot of ways a lot more honorable, a lot more benevolent, a lot more decent than the authorities. So it's, you know, to the point where they've done a lot of kind of petty acts of kindness that got them nothing and in some cases actually cost them stuff, just because it was the right thing to do and or they felt bad for somebody and or they just felt like it.
Yeah.
And what do you do with that? Because, like, the whole setting itself is really kind of harsh and brutal, and there aren't a lot of safety nets. There's not a lot of mercy. The corporations just look at, you know, people as human resources and stuff like that. And so it's the Robin Hood problem, right? When the authorities are evil, where does that put the outlaws?
Yeah. Brandon, go ahead real quick, and then I want to move on. Well,
that's kind of the point that I wanted to drive at is, like, you're supposed to be, of course, the criminals, but everything's terrible. Like, I got into Shadowrun.
Good man.
I'm reading it. I got into it because of Save Against Fear, where I played Shadowrun and realized I really, really liked this. And the thing, good.
You and I will have to geek out about the Shadowrun setting for a while.
Okay. just to put this on record, Brandon has accepted something double mumbo jumbo. Everybody give him, like, no end of the business about this. Like,
that's
constantly for years.
I reject that. All right.
I have made my decree. Right. We can move on.
All right. Okay.
Anyway, finish your point, and then I want to.
Oh, but on. Yeah, the thing is, it's one of the things that says is no matter what you do, you pay. And I do like the whole idea of the you know, trying to get out, because that is a common theme that I've read in this things is how everyone wants to get out or just kick the can down the road. Because that's usually the two ways is do you have hope? You want to get out. If you don't have hope, then, you know, then you're just gonna stay in there and just kick the can down the road. Because I mean, the only other way to do is, oh, are you gonna be a wage slave at one of the corps? Like, that's a great way to have a Shadowrunner come in and totally ruin your day, and then you'll be out on the streets. Like,
right. Unless it's our group, in which case they will do their level best to make sure your day is not ruined.
Well, yes, but you guys, that's kind of the one thing that sets you guys apart. And of course, Brandon, how many noir crime dramas are all about one last job before you get out and go straight, right?
I'm retired.
Right, you know, oh, no, I'm out of the business, right? I mean, it's a common trope. To my answer to Jacob's question, by the way, most spiritually challenging campaign or character you've done and how to deal with it is the other campaign I'm kind of planning in my head, which is the Rogue Trader campaign, because that is set in the Warhammer 40K universe, and it's dark and ugly and horrible. And everybody believes in a God Emperor, who is a supremely powerful psychic.
What do you mean? Like, it seems
tries
like
to hold together the entire Imperium that stretches across most of the galaxy, and it's a big, ugly, terrible, gritty, grimdark mess. So
it seems like it's punchline rainbows.
Well, yes. Except all of those things were made of
Imperium
acid
of Man
and mild
is Stalinist
bullets.
Russia meets the Spanish Inquisition.
I don't know. It sounds like a wonderful place to live. Wonderful place.
And by the way, Jacob, if your fiance wants to reconcile her belief with salvation, with the existence of alien worlds, I'm going to do what I always do and recommend that you read C.S. Lewis. It's either Mere Christianity or Miracles. I can't quite recall. He does actually talk a bit about salvation and alien races, and his answer is essentially, we'll see when we get there.
Question, Grant. In Miracles, does it explain how magnets work?
Just go home. You're done.
Grant said a little bit before he dives through the internet and strangles Brandon. reading some of C.S. Lewis's fiction, the Space Trilogy might help with that too.
Yes, actually the Space Trilogy is a very interesting way to approach it. Maybe not suitable for a campaign, but really neat and well worth reading.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to jump... Jack's got another question, but I want to answer a question from Mike Perna, who, of course, is on GameStore Profits and Rhodes Ministries, etc., a guy who we've had on the show before as well. And I want to answer his question mostly just because we haven't answered one of his yet. I talk a lot about the dwarf bard in our Pathfinder game. I know. I've seen all your posts and listened to some of those episodes, Mike, and they're all awesome. Keep it up. When I saw a class guide for the system, under dwarf it said, don't. Just don't ever play a dwarf bard. How often do you guys play suboptimal class/race combinations, and does it help or hurt? To generalize this a little bit more, suboptimal combinations of game features and crunchy game choices. I am all for it, and I think it's fun. Some of that is because I used to be a terrible power gamer and would read those guides and live and die by them. And so I've kind of had this reaction the other way that is basically, I want to get away as far away from this as possible and never do anything like this and be as iconoclastic as I can possibly be. There's tropes are a trope for a reason, and I think that's okay. But at the same time, there's a lot of fun playing those suboptimal combinations, and suboptimal is only suboptimal when you're looking at this one particular thing. You've got a dwarf bard. Okay, is he quite as charismatic? Are his songs and spells quite as powerful as others? No. Can the others find their way around in the Underdark? Probably not. So, trade-offs.
Yeah, like, that's sort of the way I would take it, is it all depends on the idea. I mean, I do, for some way, like, okay, well, if I'm going to play a bard, I kind of want to play something that's charisma powered up. But, like, that's where my, like, power gaming tends to slow down. Like, I have people who I game with who are a whole lot more well-versed in power gaming and what you have to do to make this character strong and all that stuff. And I'm just like, look, you don't need to always do this, you know, break it down to the geometry and make sure that, well, this is the best spell and this is the best thing and this is that, because that can't be fun. If you want to play a character who your interesting concept is I wield two weapons and that's really what I want to do, and I want to be a fighter who wields two weapons, okay, fine. Like, that's great.
Yeah. Here's my question. Is your entire game going to be, I do the same thing over and over again, and if I ever fail, then the game stops until I succeed? Because I've played in those campaigns where it was, we have obstacles, we will do the same thing repeatedly, and once we roll enough of the magic number, we get to go forward and have more plot. And that's really all the mechanics were. So if, you know, your game is, if you are only doing bard things, and you need to do your bard things well, because when you don't do your bard things well, the story doesn't go forward, no, there's no reason to play anything but the most min-maxed bard. If you're doing things that are dwarf things and bard things and people things, and where are we? I don't even know. Space has 17 dimensions and I can see all of them and it's very strange. What do I do? Well, okay, sometimes being a dwarf bard is bad. Sometimes being a dwarf bard is good. Sometimes being a dwarf is bad or good. A bard, bad or good. Sometimes having 2 feet is, you know, inconsequential. Who knows? But if the campaign is interesting and you have agency in it, optimal stops really being the right term, and it's, hey, I'm interesting and multifaceted, not I'm doing the same thing over and over, and I should do it better so that I don't feel that this evening is a waste. Go play, I don't know, poker instead. You'll get the same result out of it, and, well, I don't know, earn more chips. Poker's probably a terrible thing to recommend. Go play Hearthstone. Go back to playing Hearthstone. Do the same thing over and over again. Go do the same thing over and over again. Go play your hunter, and then you'll get the same enjoyment out of it because you've done the same thing over and over and won more than you've lost.
Don't go playing Hearthstone.
And if you're wondering why I've been so quiet on this one, I always play humans, which are always at least somewhat optimal. So,
listen, I have played half fey, strongheart halflings with like 6 different classes and prestige classes because I was a tremendous power gamer. All right, I have been there.
I played an archangel once, but I think that's really the only time I've played a non-human character.
I played a basically orc barbarian in the short-lived Peter game. Not a barbarian, sorry. Basically orc paladin in the...
Yeah, and you know what? It was interesting because he was a paladin and because he was an orc, not because he was a weaker paladin.
Yeah. Garros Ashwalker or whatever it was.
Yeah, he was an Ashwalker.
Yeah.
Right.
Which are kind of this. We're not going to dig into my setting design, especially since what they are has changed in my writing. So.
All right.
Also, Jack Birkenstock says, "Power to the Iconoclast." So, hooray! speaking of Jack, how do you feel about the current trend in role-playing games to help guide people towards inter- and intra-character conflict? Where do you see it going?
I think it's wonderful, and I can't wait to see what the Bodana group does with it. Nudge, nudge.
Wink, wink. Finish your book, Jack.
I'm loving it because I play Monster Hearts. And when I'm getting ready to play Monster Hearts, I'm realizing that I don't have to plan as much. I mean, I have to come up with at least some of a... If nothing hits me, we're in trouble. But even if nothing hits me, I can usually probably fake a little bit until I get an idea. Because it's all about possibly... what is this character doing that's upsetting this other character, third character, you tell me. And now all three of those people are interested in that scene.
Yeah.
Because two of them are participating, one is dictating what's going to happen, and the fourth person, like, is probably like, ooh, like, I just got done with my thing, let's see what happens with your thing. Right. And so that leads on to more interesting character conflict, and I like it. I mean, I always will have a deep-seated, you know, part in my heart where I want it to be about us versus the outside. I mean, I recently tried to do a game where it's like, okay, this is going to be all about inter-party conflict, and my party basically said, we don't want this, we want to be heroes still. And I'm like, alright, and we redesigned the game.
Buy-in is the magic word, I think, right?
Yeah.
You gotta have buy-in. And I am fine with the design trend going that way as long as there are also games that don't have that, because I think some people thrive with... Given the choice, I will not play a game that has a ton of intra-party conflict. It's just not really my style. I'm there to have fun with my friends, not argue with them.
But
there are some people who have fun arguing with friends, so, you know.
To give a slightly more serious answer, I have some fun with them in moderation, like con games, for instance. I have played in A Wicked Age at a convention, and actually Shannon's annual The Trouble with Rose game features some inter-party conflict, and because it's in a very lighthearted setting, it's not as... it's not at all upsetting when it happens.
Yeah. Right.
And I love Fiasco, and it's all about that, but again, it's buy-in. Right up front, I know it's going to be this.
Well, and it's short, too, right? I mean, it's not something that goes on for ages.
Oh, I could not do a sustained, like, vampire LARP kind of thing where you're all scheming against each other. I just couldn't do it.
Yeah, I'd find that uncomfortably stressful.
I think so, too. I'll admit, yeah. Peter, what you're saying about it being a con game really works, because as I just went to Fear the Con, and when I went to Fear the Con and when I went to Save Against Fear, I had games where I was like, okay, well, I really don't care about this character. In the first game I played in Save Against Fear, at Fear the Con, sorry, it was what's called Don't Rest Your Head, and I went into that game thinking my character's probably going to die, and I was a little disappointed that my character didn't die. I tried to ride a huge bomb down the shaft of death, but they're like, no, you don't have to do that, and I'm like, but I want to.
Would be so cool.
Yeah. Like, it would be so cool that the last thing you see is my character on top of the bomb as it explodes.
Oh, if my character is not dead at the end of a Fiasco game, I am not happy.
Oh, I am happy if my character is alive at the end of a Fiasco game, because the first Fiasco game I played, which is one of the three games I've played now since Save Against Fear, and that was all about inter-party conflict. I was trying to get one of the other players dead before the twist. Like, and it was my character's job to set up his murder. And in a game, in a All Flesh Must Be Eaten game, I tried to, like, basically murder another two player characters because we were playing a military unit and I was more concerned about getting out. And it was just all this frustration, and I nearly shot them in the face.
And, you know,
I failed a roll.
Yeah. But yeah, I am all for it, sure. And obviously Jack, as executive director of the Badonna Group, which we will link again in the show notes, and you should all go check out if you haven't read up on them already, because they're awesome. You know, obviously the stuff he's doing with, you know, using RPGs as a therapy tool, maybe it's really good for you. I think picking a game like that for the right group that can handle it would be awesome for the kind of stuff that Jack is doing.
Also, apparently he's finishing a chapter as we're doing this, so good job. Jack. Keep it up.
Yes, well done.
Yes.
But yeah, it's, you know, for the kind of stuff where the players can handle it, I think it's awesome. If it's just going to cause trauma and people, again, if somebody's designing a game to specifically push boundaries and break through lines and veils, kind of whether the players want to or not, I think that's a problem. If it's, hey, this is going to be fun and we're all going into it and we know it's safe, even though it's all inter-party conflict and dealing with inter-character issues, awesome. Have at. Okay, some other questions.
I did want to mention, so to call this out, Jacob apparently has indeed read C.S. Lewis. And he knows this specific quote, I have all of the previously stated books. So
good,
he's
man
on top of it.
Yeah, well done. All right, another one from Nathan here. Is killing off a character because they aren't interesting a good storytelling choice in RPGs? That's a...
Not necessarily killing off, but writing out of the story at least temporarily, I think, often is.
Yeah, I am okay with doing that. My question then is killing them off going to get you any storytelling good?
I think also you can't be, like, in the GM's chair and say your character is insufficiently interesting and therefore dead.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of an inappropriate thing to do to your players.
It very much crosses that boundary between GM control over the story and player agency, right?
Yeah.
I mean, unless
you talk to the player and say your character is terribly boring and we got to fix this, but fix it. Don't be like, you know, don't put it down because it wasn't interesting enough. Go make another one.
Well, see, the only way I would successfully say in doing that is if you're actually kicking the person out of the group. Because if it's like, your character is boring, we don't want to play with you, get out. Like,
I would say
the worst way to handle it ever.
It's a terrible way to handle it. I almost... No, don't do that. Talk to the person. Like, listen.
You should do, yeah.
Fix this. Having said that, I have asked the GM to kill off a character because I was bored with them, and I was hoping that their death would generate some activity on the part of the other players. And that didn't happen because the GM killed my character in a very boring way.
I have had the exact same experience, only not only did the GM kill my character in a very boring way, he did it in a very passive-aggressive way that indicated that he was displeased at having me not continue to play the same character.
Yeah. Whereas mine died and was never heard from or mentioned again because he was boring. Nathan, by the way, says, well, it might do some storytelling good. So he's definitely of the opinion that this is something that can be done. And, you know,
and I agree. I totally agree with that. But it depends on the story. Like, if it depends on the story and how the way you kill it off. Because you guys have basically just said that there were a couple times in the stories where, oh, the character was not killed off properly and it didn't add anything to the game, blah, blah, blah. So in that case, I would say that it probably would have been better if that character just faded into the background. In the case of you, Peter, where you were like, oh, he was obviously upset about you changing your characters, well, that's kind of a problem with the GM. And I mean, I, as the GM, have been really, really upset that a character is like, oh, no, I don't want to, you know, I want to change my character up and all that stuff. But the thing is, I've had to replace characters before in a lot of games. In fact, I don't know if I've mentioned this, we basically had a character die in the last Dresden Files game we ran. It was less that a character died, actually, and more that he took up a coin of the Denarian.
Oh, you did mention that, yeah.
Yeah, and...
I think you mentioned that in the Monsters episode, actually.
Yeah, that was really, really, you know, whoa, okay. Did not expect that coming. But, like, it was a logical progression for the character. Now, if he just said, oh, no, I'm going to do this, and it ruined my plot, I would might kind of be upset, and I might express that being upset with a, you know, subpar, well, you just go off and die then. Like, whatever. But,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think for NPCs, which is Nathan's follow-up here, if an NPC is not interesting, killing them off won't do any storytelling good because nobody will care.
Yeah.
Yeah, writing them out of the story in some other way is probably better because it just saves you having to dwell on them.
Or making them interesting.
Oh, terrible, a character died. Who? Him. All right. That's
Jay.
That's what you're going to get. They've got to be interesting before their death is meaningful or their absence is meaningful.
Or something about their death has to make them interesting. Yeah. Like, if you have a fairly boring character, but they, you know, they're the first, they're patient zero from, like, the invading alien parasites or something, and they turn into, like, this weird, alien-dominated walking
device,
you know,
right?
Yeah.
Well, you know, the mysterious corpse in the street that gets you involved into a murder mystery, you don't know anything about them. Their death is interesting, but really, that is not a character at that point. That's an object that you'll start to investigate the history of.
And or when Bob the Baker just all of a sudden grabs the sword off the wall and starts holding the enemies away as you guys get out and you see him fall, well, that was just an interesting death to a, you know, boring character, but, like...
Right, and you know, is that a plot device where, well, my players need to make it out of here, or the story falls apart? Well, then it kind of rings hollow.
Yeah.
If you've talked to Bob, though, and he's your friend, well, now that death is meaningful. So I think the two are pretty closely interlinked. Let's do move on, though. But good question, Nathan.
Yeah.
It's a good question. Another one from Mike. How do you guys balance between playing the sorts of characters you like to play and falling into a trope or cliche?
Poorly.
I've said before, I don't mind tropes. Tropes exist for a reason. I try and twist it in some way, like a dwarf bard or a really dumb brute who's got it, you know, the thing that makes him powerful, is a very intelligent magic hammer that only he can hear. So he's got the voice of wisdom in his head, and he's too stupid to figure it out. Right? That was Newton, my favorite dumb brute character.
Oh, here comes Blairy again. Joy.
Oh, hello, train. So I think, basically, I have no problem taking the trope, taking the cliche, and twisting it into something I find interesting. And I don't mind that happening during play. It's okay to say, you know what, I'm playing for this Rogue Trader Warhammer 40K game I am playing a priest of the Ecclesiarchy, and, you know, it's flamethrowers and heretics all around. But then something neat will develop during play and interaction with the rest of the characters and the world, and he'll become more interesting than that. I think that's fine.
Well, like, and
this is, by the way, what Brandon has to deal with all the time, this train.
That's why I have a theme song for it, because then instead of it being a horrible, terrible, annoying thing, it's something awesome. I get to sing the song. Anyway. In your audio, yeah.
Brandon wrote that song, by the way.
Yes, I
did. You can blame him.
It needed one. Anyway, as...
It did.
You can buy our Blairy the Podcast Train plushies.
No, you can't. No, you can't. No. Although
you
I may have to make a
Blairy those podcast ever, train or even think about them. No, wrong.
All right, I may have to make a Blairy T-shirt at some point. Anyway,
we need a Blairy logo. You guys make it. All right. So, how do you guys balance between the sort of characters you like and trope? My answer to this is, I always play what I want to play. Like,
right. And if it happens to be a trope, who cares? And if it isn't, who cares, right?
Yeah, the thing is, I what I usually play is the face of the party, because I like playing characters that are socially up there, that are talking, that are using words to solve the problem. Even if it puts me in danger. There have been games where I've played the bard where we saw, oh, those are intelligent creatures in the next room. All right, so instead of fighting them, I'm going to step in first. I'm going to announce myself, and I'm going to greet them in their native tongue.
And all of a sudden, you're playing basic D&D, where the whole point was to not get killed in fights and find treasure.
Yeah, and if they walk in on me, then they're like, all right, well, and if they roar and attack and jump me, you guys are through the door in 5 seconds, all right? If not, I will get us what I can. And I love doing it. So I always play something that has a high charisma, where I put points in a bluff or diplomacy, so I can do that. The hardest point is when I'm playing a barbarian, which I don't do that in, or a fighter, and which is why I tend not to play those. But if I have to play something, I probably won't just play a fighter, unless I somehow make that fighter a courtly fighter who knows how to talk to people, because that's what I enjoy, and so I love being the face.
Okay, so and I'm going to do a little exercise here. Grant, what kind of player or what kind of player characters do I make?
You.
Yeah.
No, seriously. Everyday heroes with a good knowledge of the criminal justice system, a sense of responsibility to society, and typically a bit older than everyone else, and technically skilled in something.
And usually some covert skills, yeah.
Yes. I mean, your pest control guy in the Inspector's game used to be a spy. I mean, come on.
Yes, poor Ozzy. The world's most put-upon former Polish spy working in...
Working in paranormal pest control, yes.
Paranormal pest control.
Yes.
None of his spy skills are at all useful, and he is so sad.
Yeah. All right. Anyway, but yes, that's who you play.
Yeah. And it's a mold that I probably should try and break out of a little bit more, but I have so much fun doing that.
Oh, don't worry. Me.
When we run the Rogue Trader game, you'll have to break out of it one way or another. It'll be hilarious.
Yeah. Well, actually, I'm thinking the next time we do traditional fantasy, I'm going to try a wizard, but at any rate...
At some point, we'll have to, I'm sure, do that. Let's move on. Are there any... Let's see. Jack was making a point about Mirror of Us, Hero with a Thousand Faces, characters as allegory and moral lessons, but I think that was in response to something a while back, so I don't... I'm sure it was an awesome point, Jack. I'm sorry we missed it. Another one from him, though. Are there ever any effects of a character that you restrict in any of your sessions, and why? Is there a point where you stop playing? Yes, and I am actually kind of a stickler for mechanics, even if those mechanics are pretty yes-and mechanics. I mean, unless that's...
You hide it well.
I try, but I mean, at some point, you have to actually roll the dice and succeed, you know?
Right.
In order to get anything done.
But I mean, I've never felt like we've been bouncing off the system in your games.
Well, no, because I hate that, and I've been scarred by that, right? But I do try, and I try and come up with interesting results for failures that aren't, and the plot doesn't go forward until you roll a success. Make it, get that magic number, please.
Well, the
that's not interesting.
Or, and you're dead.
Yeah, well, like, it's the problem that I had with, the thing that I had in my in my Dresden Files game, one of the last sessions thing happened. We had a character who was doing something, and he failed the roll. And so I went to him, and I'm like, you have two choices. You can completely, totally fail and just not get this bonus thing that we're having, or I'll let you succeed and get the bonus thing you're happening, but something bad is going to happen.
Right.
And he's like, he asked if everyone else could try first, to try to help him first. Everyone tried, everyone failed. And he's like, okay, I choose the succeed, but bad thing happened.
Right. Success with consequences is usually much more fun than, no, you failed. But to get to Jack's point, I think obviously at some point there are lines and veils that you have to pay attention to. But by and large, if a character can do something within the system, I'm cool with it. Maybe that's just my power gaming roots where, you know, I'm helping design characters that do 1.6 billion D6 damage in a round and silly nonsense like that. But
and that's really not an exaggeration, which is the horrifying thing.
Yeah, I walked these two guys through the whole thing. Chuck is hilariously fun. I'm just going to say that right now. Tremendous amount of math, but hilariously fun. Anyway, and yes, that was D&D 3.5. Go ahead, Brandon.
The thing that I say, I actually am probably opposite. I'm probably one of the least permissive GMs. When someone comes up to me with an idea, my initial reaction is no, mainly because of an invisible horse, which I think I've told about on the podcast before. We had a character.
No, this is the one gaming story that you haven't told on the mics, I think.
I concur.
All right. So it was in my Inquisition game. We had a guy who was a power gamer, and he was playing from the Book of Exalted Deeds because, hey, we were playing members of a church. Why not use the Book of Exalted Deeds?
It was badly written and 3-0. But yeah, I get what you're saying.
But he pushed for it because he wanted to be a saint. And I'm like, okay, fine. Well, you have to be a saint of something. Well, I'm a saint of this. All right, fine. Whatever. Like, because I usually say no, but I usually cave. But what ended up happening is this guy, he had, okay, well, as this, I want to have a mount, and my mount is going to be a Pegasus. Okay, your mount is a Pegasus. Fine. We already had other characters who had the ability to fly and do things, so I'm like, okay, having a flying horse, that just means we have more flying party members. Okay, I'm cool with that. But then, when he started doing things, the horse seemed a little bit too awesome. Like, he was at something, and then he's like, oh, my horse casts greater Pegasus casts greater invisibility on us. I'm like, what? Like, it's like, yeah, it's in the monster manual stats, and he pointed to it at the book, and I was just like, alright, fine, it happens. It wasn't until later in that game that we discovered that what he was pointing at was the entry to Phantom Fungus that just happened to have the picture of the Pegasus above it. So yeah, I tend to, because of that, say no, I don't want to do anything. It's going to unbalance the game. I don't want to have to deal with this stuff.
So right. He had a Phantom Fungus Pegasus.
Yes.
Which actually, okay, you know, creepy fungal ghost Pegasus, I would totally bring into a game.
Yeah, I was like, saying. That would be awesome, actually. Yeah,
Eldritch horror are you writing? I mean, come on.
Yeah. And Jack, how is it not clarifying you yet?
Jack is clarifying his question, by the way. He's asking more about personalities that you object to in the game, things that affect your game, like a quirk that they play. I'm playing a murderer, or that sort of thing. Not so much mechanical.
Unless it happens to do, for me personally, unless it happens to do with something that's going to violate someone's lines and veils, no. Like, for example, in the one of the Monster Hearts games I'm playing, we have a character who wanted to play made out of cloth skin, which we are calling the Enchanted, which derives from the book Ella Enchanted, which is the story of Cinderella, basically told in a different way, which the girl has a curse on her, where any order that is given to her, she has to follow. And this is a character that this person wants to play out. But she's uncomfortable in being ordered to do certain things romantically.
Sure. There's a big obvious, line to cross there.
Yeah, she doesn't want to order to be doing anything physically, romantically, because that's just not there. So we've come up with...
It's a little rapey. Let's be blunt.
You will automatically succeed in ignoring all of those things. And we have that as up there, because I'm not about to violate her lines by this character that she wants to play. So if someone says, well, I'm not interested in someone playing Dexter because that kind of creeps me out. Like, then I'm good with that. I'm like, okay, then no one's gonna play the psycho murderer who has, a code of ethics. That's why he's working with you guys. Yeah. I for the longest time did not allow people to play evil of any alignment until, of course, I played an evil character and then loosened up on that, because I thought, no, it's just terrible and I want you to be heroes, so you have to be of the, good alignment. If you fall to evil, I'm taking your character away from you.
Right.
But,
yeah. I haven't had too much trouble with this. This goes back to me having an unusually idyllic gaming history. It hasn't been perfect, obviously. I've given examples of where it hasn't been, but a lot of this really kind of egregious outlier stuff I have not run up against. I really am not terribly interested in running a game with characters that are despicable. It doesn't really sound fun to me. Little bits of, kind of dark streaks and stuff, fine. There's a character in the GURPS game that seems to have died to scheduling conflicts and the fact that Shadowrun is more fun, which I now, unfortunately, Shadowrun is suffering from the scheduling conflicts, and I'm really sad, but
we're going to get it back, I promise.
Yeah, we will. It might not be until after the first of the year, but we will get it back.
This is still Savage Shadowrun, right?
This is still the Savage Run game, yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Because if you were actually playing Shadowrun, I would have to find you and beat you until
no,
you...
Shadowrun game is really good, but yeah. You're already anyway. In 27 games, so you're
fine. Anyway, but yeah.
Yeah, I really don't... I guess I've said all I need to. I don't have an interest in, as a GM, playing for, or, running a game for characters that are going to just be nasty and cruel and stuff in my world.
And for me, it's basically, is this character designed to just let me do whatever I want and kind of ruin the game? Like, I'm playing a chaotic, neutral thief with no morals and a objectivist outlook on life. That's not going to fly, because that's not an interesting character. If you have made an interesting character and you're playing to it, I'm not too worried about it.
Even if you can play a chaotic neutral thief and have them be interesting, see Jack Sparrow.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, Jack Sparrow, because he's got, he's playing all sides against each other, but he's got a goal in mind that is good-ish. That works fine. This is going to sound kind of silly. Linden, one of the follower characters you get in Diablo 3, totally a chaotic neutral thief, I mean, quite literally, a chaotic neutral thief. Except his brother is a town guard, and his brother is in prison. Because Lyndon showed up at a heist, his brother, Lyndon was stealing, his brother showed up just a little too late to catch him, and the rest of the guards thought his brother was in on it and helping him out, so they threw him in jail.
Oh.
And so Lyndon is traveling the world trying to figure out how to deal with this and maybe raise money to get him out. And also his brother married the woman he loved, so how does he deal with this? He's supporting the family by stealing from other random people. Interesting character. I'm down with it. That's cool. Let's resolve that story during play, right? But that's a lot different from, I am a boring halfling thief who steals everything and just says, I'm playing my character when you call me on it.
Yeah.
Totally different.
I think that gets into the whole Kender argument that was had.
It does. And I'm cool with Kender, again, if they're interesting. If the player's being a jerk, it's a player issue. It's not a character issue. We are over an hour and a half, so Brandon, you're going to have fun editing.
Yes, I am. I'm good. We got a couple questions left. I think
we do, and these are all fun, short questions, so let's knock these out. And these are all from Nathan, so Nathan, thanks. What do you think of the Dungeons & Dragons episodes on Community? I haven't watched them. Community is fun. I'm not a big sitcom person, but Community is
one sitcom I could enjoy. Community is awesome. I enjoyed both of them. I particularly liked the ending quote at the end of the second episode where Abed is like, it's like, no, I am a dungeon master. I create a world and I bind it by rules. You know,
right.
It's like,
which plays into the whole thing of Community being entirely in Abed's imagination.
Yeah.
And that's one of the fan theories that makes a ton of sense.
And he basically goes, it's like, if you show up in someone's cap, have a 2-hour fight about who's going to, you know, kill him at the front door, he goes out the back door.
Yep. Could you please redo your episode on video games? It was kind of short. You know, at some point I'd like to focus a little more on video games, but I think we've kind of evolved as a podcast. We were originally going to kind of do a lot with video games, and turns out tabletop gaming is full of all sorts of stuff that is applicable to video games from a storytelling perspective. At some point I'm sure we're going to talk about video games more. I mean, it's what we do. And I'd like to bring some video game people on at some point, but I don't know.
Well, and we do use them as examples from time to time.
Oh, sure. All the time.
We've quoted Mass Effect and Dragon Age and Dungeons of Dreadmore. And
yeah. And lastly, do any of you have a personal theme song you like whistling to yourself? No, I tend to have kind of this constant radio station in my head of constantly changing music. I'm never without some song in my head, but it changes almost hourly. My earworms don't last long, but they're constantly there. Like today I've had one of the Chrono Trigger themes in my head all day. That's me.
It's based on the false assumption that I can whistle, which I cannot.
Yeah. These.
My daughter asked me to yeah. My daughter, by the way, asks me to stop singing. She's 2. Apparently I can't sing.
All right. As I said, these are fine.
Or as a 2-year-old, she doesn't have musical taste yet.
Oh, no, she's fine with mommy singing, but daddy cannot sing. Daddy, stop. Stop.
All right. As I've said for the third time, these are playing constantly, usually on podcasts. So I usually drown out anything else in my head because I'm usually have this. Otherwise, it's the Blurry the Podcast Train episode thing.
Yeah, obviously that's just stuck in your head all day.
Oh yeah.
All right, and that's actually all of our questions. I do want to thank everybody who has tuned in to listen and watch us live. You guys are awesome, and thank you so much. And I'm really excited that we got to really interact with some of you guys and do some of this live. That was a ton of fun.
Yeah, this was good. We'll have to do this again.
Oh, yes.
We'll see. I don't know that this is going to be an every episode thing, but we definitely need to do more of it. Who knows? We'll figure it out. Cool. Does anybody have anything else?
No, yes. I think I'm good.
All right. I've been waiting to do this for a long time because Peter and Grant, definitely Grant, you said we'd do this, but I am looking for people who possibly make drawings to make a couple characters for us, particularly there are a couple inside jokes going around the podcast about the nature of several hosts. Such
oh, boy. Here we go.
All right, so I'm sure you've...
Well, thanks for tuning in, and...
We're going to forcibly close the audio now and run screaming into the night.
No, go ahead, Brandon.
All right.
Go ahead.
But yes, as
you're
I made...
You're only editing to your editing. Editing. Did I just say editing? It's too late.
Editing. It's like editing,
quick,
but backwards.
Quick thing for those of you on YouTube. When we started, this pot of espresso was full. Just saying.
But anyway, as I said, I've come up with a couple of interesting characters for us. The first is RoboGrant, because of Grant's new computer and the fact that we were joking about putting him into a robot. Then there is, of course, Peter the Paladin, because, as we all know, Peter only plays with good characters and good groups and things like that. And I am Evil Overlord Brandon. So... I challenge anyone out there with any artistic ability whatsoever to draw one or all three of those people, along with possibly Blairy the Podcast Train. Not necessarily all together, but hopefully in separate pictures. If you want to do one all together, I suppose that'd be good, too.
If nothing else, we can do that as like a thing for our Facebook page, right? Like the banner or something. That would actually be a lot of fun.
Yeah. But I really would like... see that, because I want to see what you were
going to do. Since I haven't had my webcam going tonight, if you want some idea of what I look like to render me, look at my Facebook stuff. I've got an actual picture of myself in there.
But yes.
Or, you know, contact him, ask him for a selfie, something like that. You know, send him a headshot, that sort of thing, right? Headshot, acting resume, they'll call you back.
Yeah, like I have any of that. Jack is saying that he has some contacts for artwork.
Awesome.
Well, so do we. I mean, you know. But yeah, if anybody wants to do this, that would be fun. And if you are okay with it, whoever ends up drawing things, I can't promise anything, obviously. But hey, who knows? Maybe a t-shirt. We'll see.
Yeah. And hey, look, if the ones that I like, I will use as profile pictures on things. Because, like, I think it'd be absolutely hilarious to have Evil Overlord Brandon as...
Basically, we are begging professional artists for free artwork, because, hey, why not?
Because that's a thing that podcasters have done for ages, and why should it stop now?
Yeah, it's not like this is a for-profit operation, all right? Come on.
This is
my parents actually asked me...
the worst for-profit thing ever, if it's for-profit.
What's funny is I had my parents over last weekend, and they actually asked me, because I was telling them, hey, I'm going to be doing this live episode, it's going to be fun. They asked me, well, now how much money do you make from podcasting?
Negative.
I just looked at
the number
like,
has a
right.
minus in front of it.
Negative lots. This is a hobby, all right? This is not a business.
Yeah.
Good times. Besides, it's a niche of a niche, right?
I think.
Yeah, come on.
You've got role players, and then you've got ones that listen to podcasts, and then you have ones that are also interested in listening to a role-playing podcast that's specifically about Christianity and its interaction with games. That's
Not all of our listeners are Christian, and I don't know that all of our listeners are tabletop gamers, although I suspect they are. But it's still a pretty small audience.
Yes. Yeah, anyway. I mean, they're at least interested in listening to us, which is we're quite the subset.
That's right, because each and every one of you is awesome.
Yes.
Yeah, we actually do have really cool listeners. Every indication I've ever gotten has just reinforced that more and more.
Oh, great people. And speaking of, if you want to interact with those listeners, on our website, savingthegamepodcast.org, there is a link to our listener community, which is a Google Plus community. You can just join the community. It's open to everybody. Hop on in, introduce yourself, and start talking, because there's a lot of good conversation that happens there. And I think that's where I should call it.
Yep.
Alrighty.
Cool. Well, from all of us here at Saving the Game, thanks for listening. Have a good night. And I can actually say have a good night, because you know when we recorded. And you're watching it right now, some of you, and more of you will watch the YouTube video. Hooray. But from all of us here at Saving the Game, have a good night. Thanks for listening. God bless.
Take care, everybody.
See ya.
And we're out.